back to life. Only you can, only you can. You set me free from every chain. You fill my heart with songs of praise. Only you can, only you can. Jesus, you're the only reason that I'm even breathing. I am wide awake. My heart beats only for your glory. My hands reach up for you to hold me. My soul sings, Father, you are holy. My feet dance to your rhythm, to your rhythm. Every beat is calling, every beat is calling out your name.
Find a home when he told Let your fire fall, cast out all my fear. Let your fire fall, your love's all I fear. Let your fire fall, cast out all my fear. Let your fire fall, your love's all I fear. Let your fire fall.
Good morning. Let's stand together and worship.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met you. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my tomb till I met you. You called my name. Call my name, and I ran out of that grave. did rescue. My sin was heavy, but chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter, I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing. Now your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future, my eyes are open. 'Cause when you call my name,
but a son belongs to it forever. So if the son sets you free, then you will be free indeed.
Yeah. chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am.
I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. Oh, I am who you say I am. Yes, I am who you say I am. Who the sun sets free. Oh, it's free.
I want to invite you to be seated if you would, and I'm going to ask you to do something different if you are physically able, okay? We are going to go to the Lord in prayer this morning. Our hearts are heavy for the situation in the world today, and what I want to ask you to do is, if you are physically able, just turn around where you're at, and on bended knee, make that chair you're seated in an altar this morning, because we need to go to the Lord in prayer as children of God today. Would you do that? Our Father, we gather before you now in your presence as your children. And Lord, in this climate that's just filled with fear, whether it be from full ICUs and overburdened hospitals and healthcare workers, from right here in Salt Lake City, across Utah, across the states, to our borders, from the United States all the way to Afghanistan and across the globe. Lord, we look at bleak circumstances, and it gives birth to frustration and profound sadness and even anger. And yet, Lord, just as we as your children are tempted to give in to fear and to fret in the face of uncertainty, your word reminds us not only of who we are, but it reminds us loud and clear when it says, "Do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you by my righteous right hand." Lord, we thank you for that reminder today. What do we have to fear if you're with us? And even at the far places, at the ends of the earth that we cannot reach with our hands and our feet this morning, we know that you are. We know that you are there. And knowing this, Justin, can you hand me the handheld mic? Hey.
Welcome to Canyons Church. There is nothing particularly special about this building or those chairs that you knelt at. What is special is that if you are a child of God, the Holy Spirit gives you access to God's throne. And it was before Him that we brought our prayers. And He hears us. I'm thankful for that. First, I want to say happy birthday to Linda Crow. She didn't think I'd know, but I do. So if you see her on the way out, be sure to say happy birthday to her. We just have a few announcements before we continue. This evening is our business meeting. So all are welcome to our business meetings, but the business meeting is for members to do the Lord's business, to make decisions. And tonight, we have a lot of important things to decide. And so if you have the time and you're a member, please come. We're going to be in this room at 6:30 p.m. tonight. Also, next week, we will not have an 8:32 worship service. We will all be together in this room because Pastor Mike Gray will be here to bring a message. And then afterwards, we will finally be able to be Baptists once again as we gather together to eat for the chili cook-off. And so make sure you bring your best recipe and baked goods, and we'll have a fantastic time during next week. Also, today is Promotion Sunday. And Promotion Sunday is where all of our children and our students move up a grade. And so I'm really excited because we see new faces in each class for the teachers. And also, I get to say congratulations to our graduates. We celebrated Ethan Cruz at the 8:32 service. And at this service, I want to recognize Caleb, Cameron, and Alexis Lawrence. They all graduated. They're all siblings. And while Alexis is only 15, she graduated from high school. And then Caleb and Cameron will be going to Bible college in California in just a couple of weeks. And so as we turn to prayer, I'm going to pray for them. I ask that you would continue to pray for them as well on that next adventure. Let's go to the Lord in prayer again. Lord, thank you for all of the blessings that you give us. While there is a hurting world, Father, I just want to also thank you for what you give us. We are unworthy of it, but we thank you for every perfect and good gift that you give us. Father, I pray for these students that are going off into the next phase of life. I pray that you would use them. I pray that you would be with them. But really, Father, more than anything, I pray that you would preserve their faith, that they would continue to follow you, that they would be drawn closer and closer to your Son. Father, I pray that you would protect that, protect their spiritual walk with you. Father, I pray that our worship this morning would be pleasing to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
You guys stand as we continue in worship.
I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good Father, is who you are, is who you are, is who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. It's who I am.
searching for answers. Only you provide us, you know, just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good Father. Who you are, who you are, who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways.
I can hardly speak. Peace, so unexplainable. I can hardly think as you call me deeper still, and you call me deeper still, as you call me deeper still into love.
How great! How great! How great!
never been, there will never be a God like you, a love so true. There has never been, there will never be a God like you, a love so true.
People, and God, that you would send your only son, Jesus, to die for us. There is no greater love, and we can only love because you love us first. How great is that love? It cannot be measured, and we give you all glory, all praise, and all thanks for your unfathomable love. It's in your precious name I pray. Amen.
You guys can have a seat. And if you are a Canyons kid and you are fifth grade and under, you head to the back and it's time for kids' church.
I've been collecting donations for a couple of weeks now, and I feel good about it. I found that the key to a profitable day is a little smile and the right amount of bell, because you don't want to get too crazy with the bell. Of course, I found that out the hard way. At the end of every shift, I want to get in that bucket and see what I brought in, okay? I want to measure my effectiveness. But I cannot pick that lock, and I have tried. I have tried using my own keys. I've tried using a hairpin, my fingernails. I can't reach my hand in the top of it either. And if I'm going to serve, I want to know how good I'm doing. You know, I got a bonus the other day for sticking very closely to the script. And believe me, honey, I would not be doing this if there were no bonuses, because I'm really putting it out there.
Really? Oh, really? Oh, does that mean something to me? That means nothing to me.
The other day, my shift supervisor said to me, well, why don't you go over to Weatherby Street and get some donations over there? I said, I don't think so. That is not my neighborhood. Here in my neighborhood, they see me and they know me and they make note, oh, okay, that's what she's doing. Because I am a servant, I'm going to serve my community, where people can, you know, see me and say hello. To whom much is given, much is required. I believe it was Kennedy that said that. It feels very good to bring myself down to the level of a servant. That's earning me a star somewhere, I know it. And I'm helping. And I feel good about it, okay? And if anyone wants to say that I'm not doing anything productive for the community, well, guess what? You try putting on a wool cape, all right? And walking around, I feel like a big donkey, all right? This isn't easy. I'm good at what I do. I'm good at what I do.
All right. Do you know her? Does anybody know anybody like that? Awesome. Well, we're going to try this again with this microphone. I have a backup plan if we go south, okay? I think we're good to go now. I want to invite you to turn this morning to Exodus chapter 29. Exodus chapter 29. And we're going to look at 25. Exodus chapter 25, verses 1 through 9. And we're going to look there and at a couple other places in Exodus as well. As you find your way there, one morning the phone rang at the church and the secretary answered it. And on the other end of the line, a fella was heard to say, "I want to speak to the head hog." And she said, "I beg your pardon?" And he said, "I want to speak to the head hog at the trough." Well, she was a bit taken back by all that. And so she said, "Do you mean our pastor?" And he said, "Well, if he's the head hog at the trough, then that's who I mean." And she said, "Well, I have never in all of my life heard such disrespect." She said, "You could call him pastor, or you can call him preacher, or you can call him reverend, but to call him the head hog is just inappropriate. And no, he's not available. He's not even in this morning." And the man replied, "Well, that's too bad. I just sold my parents' estate, and I wanted to give $3 million to the church's building fund." And without hesitation, without skipping a beat, the secretary said, "Hang on just a second, sir. I believe I heard the little porker just walk in." Giving. That's our topic for today. Giving is a topic that makes a lot of people very nervous. It's a topic that can awaken legalism. For example, how much is expected of me? It's a topic that can awaken pride, like the video. Look at me. Look at what I'm doing. Look at what I give. It's a topic that can awaken territorialism. I give, therefore, I expect this. It's a topic that can awaken even rebellion, and rebellion in the heart for perhaps right now, even just hearing that today's message is on giving, you're thinking, which door could I get out of real fast right now? But the reality is, when we look at Exodus 25, 1 through 9, and where we're going to look this morning at other places in Exodus, it's really less about giving, and it's more about the heart of giving. And so I want to read verses 1 through 9 for context this morning. If you'll look there with me at Exodus 25, 1. "The Lord spoke to Moses, 'Tell the Israelites to take an offering for me. You are to take my offering from everyone who is willing to give. This is the offering you are to receive from them: gold, silver, and bronze, blue, purple, and scarlet yarn, fine linen, and goat hair, ram skins dyed red, and fine leather, acacia wood, oil for the light, spices for the anointing oil and for the fragrant incense, and onyx, along with other gemstones, for mounting on the ephod and breastpiece. They are to make a sanctuary for me so that I may dwell among them. You must make it according to all that I show you, the pattern of the tabernacle as well as the pattern of all its furnishings.'" And so when we pick up right there, we're just going to make a few quick observations. We notice, first of all, observation number one, that the Lord commissions his people. The Lord commissions his people. How does he do this? We have a pattern that has emerged in Scripture that we should have become used to by now. The Lord speaks first to his servant Moses. In fact, verse number one says very clearly, "The Lord spoke to Moses." And to be clear, the Lord is commissioning all of his people. He is commissioning Israel as a whole, not just one man, not just Moses, but Moses is his servant and his mouthpiece. So the Lord tells Moses what he's to do, and it says here in Exodus 25:2, "Tell the Israelites to take an offering for me. You are to take my offering from everyone who is willing to give." In today's vernacular, he's asking Moses to pass the plate, if you will, or to set out some boxes for people to contribute these things to. He's calling on Moses to call the people to give. But I want to go right there immediately. Notice the hint at the heart. You are to receive this offering from everyone who is willing to give. To be willing means to be eager, to be ready, to be prepared to do something. Now, I don't know about you guys, but when it comes time to go to the dentist, I don't go eagerly. I don't go, well, I guess I do go willingly, but I don't go eagerly. I go begrudgingly to the dentist. It's something that I've just got to go and do. When it comes to eating Brussels sprout, if it is prepared for dinner, I will eat it. If I am at your house, okay, I will eat it. But do I do so happily? No, but let me give you a little bit of, just a little hint here. If you wrap bacon around it, it really... Do I pay taxes for fun? I mean, is that something that I enjoy doing? No, I do it as a good citizen, but it's not something I really eagerly do. But when it comes to giving this offering, the Lord tells Moses to take an offering from those who are willing, ready, eager, and joyful. And what he is doing here is he is pointing to the heart. Verses 3 through 7, it gives all these descriptions of what is to be given there this morning. But you see the list, and all of these things that are to be given are in order to accomplish an objective that God's calling them to. He says, this is the offering you are to receive from them. But then in verse number 8, it says, they are to make a sanctuary for me so that I may dwell among them. So all of these things are going to go towards the building of that tabernacle, of that sanctuary. And so there are two key ways that the Lord is commissioning his people here in the context of the Old Testament and the building of the tabernacle that actually carries over into the New Testament. He is calling on his people to give, but he is also commissioning his people to work, to serve, to get about the business of accomplishing this objective together. And so it's necessary for the giving and the serving if the work is going to be finished. Do you see that? And so if we continue, verse number 9 says, you must make it according to all that I show you, the pattern of the tabernacle as well as the pattern of its furnishings. God did not leave them in the dark. He gave them details. He laid the pattern out. The Lord shows all that is to be done. And so from right here at chapter 25, verse 10, all the way through the middle of chapter 30, we see all the details of the ark, of the table, of the lampstand, of the tabernacle, etc. Pastor Justin gave us a glimpse into that 2 weeks ago when he moved over and cheated, by the way. I'm just kidding. He moved into the New Testament, didn't he? And he gave us the Cliff's Notes version, the abridged version in Hebrews chapter 9. And I know you're thankful because he did that in about a half an hour. If he had gone through Exodus 25 through 30, we might still be sitting here right now. So all of those details, however, is the pattern. Verses 3 through 7 are the things necessary to complete that pattern, to do it the way the Lord showed them. Which leads to number 2. Not only does the Lord commission his people, but this is good news. The Lord provides for his people. It would be one thing for the Lord to call on his people to give something they couldn't give, or to send them out to try to find something on their own that would be difficult to find. It's another thing to call on them to give what he has already provided. I don't know, I just want to see by a show of hands, how many of you have ever been snipe hunting? Keep your hands high for just a second if you've been. It helps me to know who I'm talking to. Now, also, those of you who have your hands up, look around at all those who haven't been yet. And make note of that because they are great candidates to take snipe hunting, right? I've been snipe hunting one time, and that was all that it took for me, okay? But I will confess to you that I have taken others snipe hunting on many occasions. Now, a snipe is a family of birds, but that's not what we're talking about when we're talking about snipe hunting. A snipe hunt is defined as a practical joke of luring an unsuspecting newcomer into trying to catch a non-existent animal called a snipe. And so it goes something like this. You take somebody out at night in the dark, deep into the woods, and you tell them to walk around in the dark, and you tell them to make silly noises, and to hold their paper bag open, and while they make those silly noises, the snipe will come and get in their bag. And so you set them out to be successful, and they make these noises, and they hold their bag, and then they turn around, and everybody's gone. That's the way it works. And that is snipe hunting. God could have sent Israel on a big snipe hunt, where they could never find it, where they could never be successful, where they could never put it all together. But that's not what the Lord did. He told them how to build the tabernacle. He told them what items were needed to build the tabernacle. And then I would point out to you that the Lord provided those very items. You say, well, where's that at? Where do you see that? As the Israelites were leaving Egypt in Exodus 12:35, it says that the Israelites acted on Moses' word and asked the Egyptians for silver and gold items and for clothing. And the Lord gave the people such favor with the Egyptians that they gave them what they requested, and in this way they plundered the Egyptians. Some people will read this and think, the Israelites sure were opportunistic. Some will read it and think, well, maybe they were greedy. But in reality, they were just obedient. The tabernacle that would be built was not courtesy of Egypt. I want you to notice this key word highlighted in your mind or in your Bible. It says, the Lord gave the people such favor. It is the Lord who is giving. He gives them favor, and these people give them these things. And now, later on, down the road, after he's rescued them, he says, you remember those things? Now bring these things to me. Bring back a gift of what has been given. And out of that, his tabernacle will be built. So don't miss it. The Lord did not just ask the people to give. He asked them to give willingly from that which he had already provided for them. And so one who understands rightly knows that God is the giver of all things anyway. Therefore, he is ready to give willingly in light of that truth. And there's the key. Recognizing that every good thing that comes into our hands is given by God, and that we are to be stewards of it, responsible for using it rightly. And there's more to that than material wealth and resources. That includes our spiritual gifts, our talents, our time, our families. Are we being a good steward over those blessings that God has given to us? In Exodus chapter 31, verses 3 through 5, we have an example of a skilled artisan. And the Lord said to Moses, I have filled him with God's Spirit, with wisdom, understanding, and ability in every craft, to design artistic works in gold, silver, and bronze, to cut gemstones for the mountain, and to carve wood for work in every craft. Translation. Let me have you right here. If you're going to sleep, I know lunch is coming. Listen, don't miss it. God did not just provide them with gold and silver. He did more than that. He provided them with the skills. He provided skilled workers to take and work that gold and that silver and do all the things that needed to be done for that tabernacle to be fashioned. And so in Exodus 25, the Lord is speaking to Moses. In Exodus 35, Moses has assembled the entire Israelite community, and he's sharing with them what God has already said to him back in Exodus 25. So, listen, Exodus 34, 4 through 9 is a carbon copy of Exodus 25, 1 through 7. What it says there, it repeats here. It mirrors it. But if we fast forward to verse 10, it says, let all the skilled artisans among you come and make everything that the Lord has commanded. Again, the Lord did not just provide the gold and silver, but the skilled workers to craft the gold and silver as well. And so what does God do today? How does He provide today? Do we take up an offering at the church? Well, of course we do. And we give, and God provides, and He meets needs, and He takes care of the things that need to be taken care of here, and we're able to do ministry. But is that all there is to it? Heavens, no. In the same way, God provides the people. God provides the skilled workers, if you will. He fills us with His Spirit. He gifts us by His Spirit. He gives us all roles and responsibilities and things to do within the body of Christ. And when we do that rightly, the church functions rightly. It's how it goes. And so God commissions us, but He also provides for us. He commissions us to give. He commissions us to serve. But we must quickly add that He gives us what we give, and He gifts us for how we serve. Isn't that good? It means God does it, not us. And if God does it and not us, who gets the glory? God does. Exodus 25:2. You are to take my offering from everyone who is willing to give. Alternate translation, everyone whose heart stirs him to give. Exodus 35:5 repeats it. Take up an offering among you for the Lord. Let everyone whose heart is willing bring this as the Lord's offering. So we pause now, and we're at the middle. It's kind of like halftime in the football game. We're at the point where the Lord has commissioned, He has provided, but what remains to be seen is how will the people respond? And the observation number three that we can make is this: willing hearts give. So the Lord spoke to Moses. Moses brought the community together. The community departs. And then in Exodus 35:21, everyone whose heart was moved and whose spirit prompted him came and brought an offering to the Lord for the work on the tent of the meeting, for all its services, and for the holy garments. Now, when you're studying the Bible, you know, sometimes you'll see a word that just keeps repeating itself. It just stands out. And if you read not only this verse, but if you read the next 8 or 9 verses, what you keep seeing is about the heart, those whose hearts were willing. And you also see that they brought those contributions to the Lord. They were giving to Him. And so, for example, in Exodus 35:22, the men and women came, and they all had willing hearts. In verse 24, they brought it as a contribution to the Lord. 26, all the women whose hearts were moved spun the goat hair. There you go. If your heart is moved by the Lord to spin goat hair, what do you need to do? Spin goat hair. Verse 29, the Israelites brought a free will offering to the Lord. All the men and women whose hearts prompted them to bring something for all the work that the Lord through Moses had commanded to be done. And so who was it that brought? It was those who had willing hearts. The Lord commissioned, the Lord provided, but those who had willing hearts were the ones who brought those gifts to the Lord. I want to tell you a real life story. I was serving at another church, and on this particular Sunday morning, we had called for a free will offering. And the goal of that offering was to enable us to get a jump start on becoming debt free as a congregation. And in advance of that free will offering, there was much prayer, there was preaching. I preached a mini series to prepare us for that. We talked about it. But when the day came for that offering to be taken up, the enemy pounced. And what I mean by that is, when I got to church that morning, if it could go wrong, it went wrong. And not only that, but there were a few people, and I want to emphasize a few, not a lot, just a few, who were pushing back against us taking up that offering at all. To say I was frustrated would be an understatement. When the time came, I explained to the church that in light of some of the questions that I'd received that morning, that I felt it was most wise for us to postpone the offering for a week or two. And I felt that it was important that we do things the right way and not the fast way. What happened next still amazes me to this day. That morning, our church family gave an offering of over $30,000 above our regular offering that morning. I couldn't believe it. I joked that I needed to call off the offering more often. The next week, we gathered once again, and there was another wave, and there was like somewhere between $15,000 to $20,000 that was given in week two to this free will offering above the regular offering because we wanted and desired to be debt-free as a church. And I look back on that, and I'm amazed. But as I look back and just observe what happened, here's what I would say. There were a few naysayers. There were. But those whose hearts were prompted gave willingly and sacrificially from what God had provided. And I will never forget what the Lord did through His people that day. Willing hearts gave. I want to come back to the statement I made earlier. When you talk about giving, it's a topic that makes people nervous. It can awaken legalism and pride and territorialism and rebellion. But time and time again, the Bible, when it comes to giving, focuses on the heart of the giver, particularly in the New Testament. The Apostle Paul said in 2 Corinthians 9, 6 through 8, the point is this: the person who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and the person who sows generously will also reap generously. And then, don't miss this, because here's the point. Each person should do as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or out of compulsion, since God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to make every grace overflow to you so that in every way, always having everything you need, you may excel in every good work. And so just like before, God commissions the giving and He commissions the serving and He provides that which we give from. And He gifts the church with spiritual gifts and talents to be able to serve. But alas, willing hearts prompted by God's Spirit must still do the giving and must still do the serving with God getting the glory. What does that look like? It doesn't always look like a big church or big budgets. It doesn't always look like that. I want to give you an example from Scripture. It's one of my favorite examples. It's from 2 Corinthians 8. Listen to this, verse 1. We want you to know, brothers and sisters, about the grace of God that was given to the churches of Macedonia. During a severe trial brought about by affliction, their abundant joy and their extreme poverty overflowed in a wealth of generosity on their part. I can testify that according to their ability, and even beyond their ability, of their own accord, they begged us earnestly for the privilege of sharing in the ministry to the saints. And not just as we had hoped, instead they gave themselves first to the Lord and then to us by God's will. Those Macedonians who were giving that day, they gave out of deep poverty and in spite of the trials that they were facing. And they did so with abundant joy. And I'm amazed, they were begging. They were begging to have the privilege of being able to give, to be a part of the work of the ministry. And their giving and their serving flowed out of this statement. And here's the key. They gave themselves first to the Lord. Listen, guys, they gave themselves first to the Lord. Themselves. Our giving will just be based upon what is expected of us if we haven't first given ourselves to the Lord. When I give myself wholly to the Lord, He doesn't get one-tenth of me. He doesn't give one-tenth of me. He gets all of me. When I give myself to the Lord, He doesn't get one-tenth of what I own, of my estate, like that's His. He gets all of it. He gives all of that to us to be stewards over it. And so we are to give the Lord control over the whole and understand that then my responsibility is to be a steward of what he has given me, which is a word we don't use very often today, but it means this, that I am going to honor God with what he's given me. I'm going to make decisions based upon what would bring honor to him and what he would desire for me to do. And so if I'm going to give cheerfully and sacrificially, then it's going to start with the fact that I've given myself to the Lord. And by the way, that begins with salvation. If we don't know the Lord, we haven't given our whole self to him, have we? And so there's where it starts. It's the opposite of that video we saw a few moments ago. It's the opposite. You see, when we give ourselves to the Lord, then stages and microphones and the applause of man is no longer of concern to us. Power and prestige, not a concern to us. In fact, those things probably are indicative of a heart problem, because we are not to be heard in saying Christ is to be exalted. And so here I am. I'm looking kind of hypocritical, aren't I? I mean, I'm standing on a platform, and some of you are thankful for that, because if I weren't, you probably wouldn't even see me at all, right? You know, I'm standing on a platform, I've got a microphone. But I'm going to tell you my prayer every Sunday morning. We gather in my study, some gather around me, we pray, and every time, almost every time, I can't say every time, but this is my heart, is that when I stand here, that I would be a spectator. And that is my heart's desire before God, that when it comes to this time, that I would be a spectator. You say, well, what does that mean? It means this: I don't want to be seen and heard. We hear enough from the world. We hear enough from men. We need to hear from God. So if I'm going to stand as Moses did before his people and say, thus saith the Lord, then I believe that I need to be a spectator, because it's God who needs to speak. And we need to stay very close to his work. So God commissioned them, he provided, they gave, and what was the result? Look at this last observation. The work is finished. The work is finished. I may have shared this before, but on one of those rare snowy days in Georgia, we get out there, we build a snowman, we, you know, make snow angels, we play football in the front yard, but us boys, we had a job to do. Did you know that? And our job was to get out there by the road with our shovels, and when that evil scraper went by, it was to take that snow and throw it back in the road. And we worked hard at it. And we persevered in that work, and it was all well done when at the end of the day we turned the radio on, yes, the radio, and we heard these words: school is closed tomorrow. Job done. Finished. Check the box. Probably had nothing to do with us, but we felt like we were part of it. Exodus 36:4. Then all the artisans who were doing all the work for the sanctuary came one by one from the work they were doing and said to Moses, the people are bringing more than is needed for the construction of the work the Lord commanded to be done. And after Moses gave an order, they sent a proclamation throughout the camp, let no man or woman have anything else as an offering for the sanctuary. So the people stopped. The materials were sufficient for them to do all the work. There was more than enough. It's like there's more than enough snow in the road. It's done. Have you ever seen that happen? Guys, quit giving. You've given too much. And yet that's what happened. And so we can say without hesitation that the Lord not only provided, but he provided more than enough. And Exodus 39:32 says, so all the work of the tabernacle, the tent of the meeting, was finished. It was done. The Israelites did everything just as the Lord had commanded Moses. Moses had finished the work. And the book of Exodus actually ends in verse 34 by saying, the cloud covered the tent of the meeting, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. There's some stuff that follows that, but that's sort of the climax. That the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. Everything was done, and here's the result. What a beautiful picture. And the same remains true today. The Lord fills his people. He saves us by his grace, and he commissions us. And he says to us, go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things I have commanded you. The Lord provides for his people. He even says in that same passage in the Great Commission, he said, remember this, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. I am with you. I am going to help you. I am going to give you all that you need. And then there's still this, though, willing hearts must give. We must cheerfully, willingly, eagerly, joyfully, not only give, but also get to the work and to do the serving. It's been said by a farmer, the hardest thing about milking cows is that they never stay milked. Think about that. The hardest thing about milking a cow is they never stay milked. You milk that cow, and what do you have to do before long? You got to milk that cow again. And I believe a lot of times Christians become frustrated because they work and they serve and they work and they serve, and it feels like they keep milking that cow again. You ever feel like that? Like you just got to do it again. I got to do this again. I got to do this again. I got to do this again. But I want to close with a picture. You see, the book of Exodus closed with the people having finished the work, and God's glory filled the temple, filled the tabernacle. There's another day coming. And in Revelation 21, verse 3, it says, then I heard a loud voice from the throne. Look, God's dwelling is with man, and he will live with them. They will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them and will be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Grief, crying, and pain will be no more because the previous things have passed away. And then the one seated on the throne said, look, I am making everything new. He also said, write, because these words are faithful and true. And then he said to me, it is done. I am the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I will freely give to the thirsty from the spring of the water of life. It is done. The Lord commissions, he provides. We're to give willingly and serve willingly. And one day, it's all going to be finished. And on that day, in this beautiful picture, we're not in this tent of meeting here on earth. We are in his presence. In glory, and the work will be done. But until then, let's keep on milking that cow to the glory of God. Amen. Amen. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for meeting with us today. Thank you for the privilege to be a part of your work, that we can give, that we can serve, and that as each one does its part, his or her part, Lord, that your body is edified and your name is exalted and your church functions the way it's intended to. Lord, I pray that you'd bless us as we serve you, that you would do so for your own name and for your own glory. Lord, I pray for one who may be here this morning who cannot say honestly that they know you as Lord and Savior. And so when I talk about the Macedonians giving themselves first to the Lord, the first thing we need to talk about is being saved, trusting you for salvation, Lord. And I pray if there's one that's within the sound of my voice today who has not yet trusted you, that they would turn from their sin and call on your name and to ask forgiveness of sin and to ask you to save them. And Lord, we know that anyone who calls on your name will be saved. So Lord, we pray that today in their heart, with their own words and with their mouth, they would cry out to you, Lord Jesus, save me. And then, Lord, give them the courage to come alongside of myself or Pastor Justin and to share that good news so we can talk to them and encourage them. Be glorified in your church, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
stumble again. I'm caught in your grace, everlasting. Your light will shine when all else fades, never ending. Your glory goes beyond all fame.
Amen. Good way to end the service this morning. Hey, I want to need a couple people to do some things. It's going to be kind of like kindergarten. It's pretty simple, but I need you to do it quick. Okay, here we go. Don Whitney's here. He's going to come and close us in prayer. He's our deacon that's on call this week. And so, Don, you go in and make your way here. Other deacons that we have who are currently serving that are active, okay, if you would make your way right over here to this front row if you're able, okay? all the deacons who are active, can you make your way right over here? Again, it's like kindergarten, but it's really fast, really fast. Okay, here they come. Thank you, guys. And so what we're going to need you guys to do, okay, after Don prays, there's going to be a video that plays, and it's going to talk about Sunday school for like 1 minute. During that video, if you are not a member of Canyons Church, you just head on out, come hug me on the neck, shake my hand, whatever, I'd love to meet you, just don't kiss me on the mouth, okay? That's all I ask. So if you're not a member, you're going to take off after the prayer, okay? If you are a member of Canyons Church, you're going to stay here, and these men are going to pass out those blank ballots to the right of those plates, and some others of you are going to stand at the door with the plates to receive the ballots. This is our deacon election, and so only members of Canyons Church are able to vote in the deacon election. So some of you, again, men, will pass out the ballots, and then two or three of you stand with plates at the door, okay? Is that clear? All right, very good. Brother Don, come close us.
So good to be in your house this morning, to worship you and praise you. Thank you for the message that's gone forth this morning. God, I pray that we would serve you well this week, that our light would shine in a dark world. We give you all honor, glory, and praise this morning. In your matchless name, amen.
In Abraham, we find inspiration to trust God with everything, just as he did by not holding back his only son. Elijah challenges us to be courageous, just as he was when he called down fire from heaven. And David encourages us to overcome any obstacle, just as he did when he slew the giant with a stone. These heroes of the faith do inspire us, but if that's all they do, we place a burden on them too great to bear. The same burden we place on ourselves when we try to live by their example. After all, Abraham was a liar. Elijah ran away to die in the wilderness when threatened, and David murdered one of his closest allies to cover up an affair. What if the Bible's heroes aren't simply models, but pictures of brokenness? People like us who need a hero too. The hero all the Bible's heroes point to, Jesus. This is the story all Scripture tells from beginning to end. The story that isn't simply about how to live, but how to live through the one who lived for us. The story that invites us to continue sharing it, inviting others to follow him until the day he returns. The good news, the story of redemption, the story of the gospel.